Good evening.
Good evening.
My name is Sean Hudgenwortel, and I will be your moderator for this evening's class. Welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school, and it is not a church. Neither are we affiliated with any religious organization. This school is a nonprofit, non-denominational, religious and scientific research organization dedicated to showing proof of the existence of Yahweh, our Elohim, and the operation of His eternal purpose, pattern, and plan operating throughout eternity to this present day. This school was established as the result of a divine vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in the year of 1931. We were incorporated in the state of California in 1958. Since then, we've established various branch schools throughout the United States and in various foreign countries. The Ontario branch was established in May of 1988. In this school, we use the true, correct, and original name and title of the Father, the Word or Son, and the Holy Spirit as contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name of our Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title of the Word or Son is Elohim. It has been improperly substituted by God. The name of the Holy Spirit, manifested in or out of a physical body, is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted by Jesus Christ. Lord and God are titles, and they are not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8 and 5 that there are Lords many and Gods many. But we now know that each Lord must have a name. And each God must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This means that Elohim is the title that our Creator chose for Himself. Jesus is a name, but it is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part into a good dictionary or encyclopedia would prove that neither the Hebrew, Greek, nor Latin languages have any letters or characters in their alphabet that would produce the sound that is made by this letter J. Neither was there a letter J in the English language until some 1,400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings for the true and original name of our Father and His Son. Christ is a title, just like Lord and God. Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state He is incomprehensible and inscrutable. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh in His pure spirit state, symbolized on this chart as a cloud. Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize Himself because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. We have this cloud drawn all around the edges of this chart to show you that everything on this chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Now, Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of Him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and form right within Himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son, a super incorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without having flesh and blood. This shape and form can only be seen in divine visions and understood in divine revelations. Later on, this self-same spirit manifested Himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world calls Jesus Christ. Now there's only one name given unto salvation, and we all must know this name. So the simple yet intelligent question that we should ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time that He walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title may be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also in this school, we teach by the divine pattern of the universe. It is called the divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt, he instructed Moses to come atop of Mount Sinai, where he showed him a tabernacle pattern in a vision. He instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. This tabernacle consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court round about. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. In this school, we show proof that everything in the universe is made and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. The 10 primary constitutional aims and objectives of the Institute are as follows. First is to help you find and know Yahweh our Elohim as he really is and actually exists. Second is to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah without distinction of race, nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third is to investigate the unexplained spirit law or so-called law of nature and the powers latent in man. Fourth is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, and modern practical and occult science. Fifth is to extirpate current superstition, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth is to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensations and ages. Seventh is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan and his demons operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensations of time. Eighth is to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith which was once delivered to the sons or children of Yahweh. Ninth is to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained that there is no other name given among men whereby man can be saved, saving the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And tenth is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of mortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace. Our slogan is speak the truth. Today we will have a prayer by Dr. Nanette Ramirez. And that will be followed by a selection of music. Our scripture lesson will be Joel, the second chapter, and that will be read by Dr. Bud Wunsch and Dr. Ramirez.
Good evening, class. Let us all bow our hearts and minds in this moment of prayer. Thank you, Heavenly Father Yahweh, for allowing us to gather here today so that we may leave here with an understanding of your purpose, pattern, and plan. All this we ask in your Son's name, Yahshua the Messiah. Let us all say, Hallelujah.
This mountain so high I could not climb, for every step that I would take forward, Satan put me three steps behind. And there was this river so deep touched my soul so gently. It was Yahshua when I troubles on my right side, and a loneliness to my left. I didn't think I belonged anywhere. I even cried when I slept. The burdens got so heavy, and I changed my name to despair. In the darkness came a light and someone standing there. My Savior and His glory. I ran for comfort when He said, peace, be still, child, and let me lift you over. He said, peace, be still, child, let me make you my
Good evening, class.
Good evening.
Tonight we'll be reading the second chapter of Joel, as soon as I can find it. And I'll be reading to you from the Holy Name Bible. It's not a King James or a Dowie. It's the Holy Name Bible. Critically compared with ancient authorities and various manuscripts. Revised by the late A.B. Traina. He happened to have been an Italian Jew. And he was with the Scripture Research Association Incorporated. This particular Bible was reprinted by Yahshua Promotions. Joel, the second chapter, on page 1034. I apologize for not being here with the right page to be on, but I was getting a prop for something. 1054. Oh, come on. I am sorry. Joel is 1054, yeah. There it is. Joel, the second chapter. Blow ye the trumpet in Zion, and sound an alarm in my holy mountain. Let all the inhabitants of the land tremble, for the day of Yahweh cometh, for it is nigh at hand. A day of darkness and of gloominess, a day of clouds and of thick darkness, as the morning spread upon the mountains. A great people and a strong, there hath not been ever the like, neither shall be any more after it, even to the years of many generations. A fire devoureth before them, and behind them a flame burneth. The land is as a garden of Eden before them, and behind them a desolate wilderness. Yea, and nothing shall escape them. The appearance of them is as the appearance of horses, and as horsemen so shall they run. Like the noise of chariots on the top of the mountains shall they keep, like the noise of a flame of fire that devoureth the stubble, as a strong people set in battle array. Before their face the people shall be in anguish, and all faces shall gather blackness. They shall run like mighty men. They shall climb the wall like men of war. And they shall march every one on his ways. And they shall not break their ranks. Neither shall one press another. They shall walk every one in his path. And though they march between weapons, they will not change their course. They shall run to and fro as in the city. They shall run upon the wall. They shall climb up upon the house. They shall enter in at the windows like a thief. The earth shall quake before them. The heavens shall tremble. The sun and the moon shall be dark, and the stars shall withdraw their shining. And Yahweh shall utter his voice before his army, for his camp is very great, for he is strong that executeth his word. For the day of Yahweh is great and very terrible, and who can abide it? Therefore also now, saith Yahweh, turn ye even to me with all your heart, and with fasting, and with weeping, and with mourning. And rend your heart, and not your garments, and turn unto Yahweh your Elohim, for he is precious and merciful, slow to anger, and of great kindness, and it grieveth him of the evil. Who knoweth if he will return and relent, and leave a blessing behind him, and he may offer a meal offering and a drink offering again unto Yahweh your Elohim. Blow the trumpet in Zion, sanctify a fast, call a solemn assembly. Gather the people, sanctify the congregation. Assemble the elders, gather the children and those that suck the breasts. Let the bridegroom go forth of his chamber and the bride out of her closet. Let the priests, the ministers of Yahweh, weep between the porch and the altar, and let them say, spare thy people, O Yahweh, and give not thine heritage to reproach, that the heathen shall rule over them. Wherefore shall they say among the people, where is their Elohim? Then will Yahweh be jealous for his land and pity his people. Yea, Yahweh will answer and say unto his people, behold, I will send you corn and wine and oil, and ye shall be satisfied therewith. And I will no more make you a reproach among the heathen. But I will remove far off from you the northern army, and will drive them into a land barren and desolate, with his face toward the east sea, and his hinder part toward the utmost sea. And his stink shall come up, and his ill savor shall come up, because he hath done great things. Fear not, O land, be glad and rejoice, for Yahweh will do great things. Be not afraid, ye beasts of the field, for the pastures of the wilderness do spring. For the tree beareth her fruit, the fig tree and the vine do yield their strength. But then, ye children of Yahweh of Zion, rejoice in Yahweh your Elohim, for he hath given you the former rain moderately, and he will cause to come down for you the rain, the former rain, and the latter rain in the first month. And the floors shall be full of wheat, and the vast shall be overflowing with wine and oil. And I will restore to you the years that the locust has eaten, the canker worms, and the caterpillar, and the palmer worm, my great army which I sent among you. And ye shall eat in plenty and be satisfied, and praise the name of Yahweh your Elohim, that hath dwelt wondrously with you. My people shall never be ashamed. And ye shall know that I am in the midst of Israel, and that I am Yahweh your Elohim and none else. And my people shall never be ashamed. And it shall come to pass afterwards that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh. And your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Your old men shall dream dreams, and your young men shall see visions. And also upon the servants and upon the handmaids in those days will I pour out my spirit. And I will show wonders in heaven and the earth, blood and fire and pillars of smoke. The sun shall be turned into darkness and the moon into blood, before the great and the terrible day of Yahweh come. And it shall come to pass that whosoever shall call on the name of Yahweh shall be delivered. For in Mount Zion and in Jerusalem shall be deliverance, as Yahweh has said, and in the remnant whom Yahweh shall call. That was Joel, the second chapter. Let's all say
hallelujah.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Ramirez, and thank you, Dr. Wunsch. Today is Thursday night, and it's our open testimony night, and by request, we'd like to have Dr. Bud Wunsch be our first speaker. But before I call you up, I'd like to welcome a returning visitor, Valerie Alcarez, returning visitor of Nanette Ramirez. So we're glad to have you with us, and we hope that something is said here today that encourages you to come back and visit us some more.
Yeah.
But with that being said, I'd like to call on our first speaker, Dr. Bud Wunsch.
Thank you. I'm wired for sound. How many people know what Birkenstocks are? Very expensive sandals, $150, $200, no problem. About 10 years ago, I'm a secondhand store addict, and I found a pair of brand new Birkenstocks, the leather ones. And every time, at least once a week or twice a week, something like that, or maybe twice a month, I don't know. But anyway, for a long time, I've been looking for another pair of Birkenstocks. And all of a sudden, here they are. It's a slightly different modification. These are to stimulate circulation in your feet and your body. But anyway, you can say, You make a prayer in sincerity, and supposedly it will come to pass. Well, took a while, but here they are. You're going to deserve better than this, our first-time visitor. I'm going to explain a little bit about, actually, I guess Marlon would be the only one that can say, yeah, that's how it was. I came into class in 1968. I moved into the camp, as they called it. And this was an area surrounding where the founder lived at 21st Street and 4th Avenue in Los Angeles. And it was a big change for me. I had been raised in a, I'll say, a moderately well moneyed. Starting in 63, I was buying a new car every other year. I got a 63 Pontiac, and then a 65 Ford Mustang, and then a 67 Thunderbird. I knew that I had enough money to buy pretty much whatever I wanted within reason. And it was a strange place because where the camp was, there was probably, I don't know, 50, 70 people that were all class members. And the founder, maybe once a month, maybe once every other month, he'd say, "Okay, guys, let's get together. We're going to go Sally shopping." And I go, Sally shopping, what's that? Well, I had been afraid as I, in my growing up, I wouldn't wear another pair of shoes that somebody else had worn. And I damn sure wouldn't put on somebody else's used clothing. But we'd go out and we'd go to maybe 3 to 5 Salvation Army stores. And if you needed a suit, there was a suit. And in at least one case, a guy, I think at the time, this was like 1968, I think a whole suit, a used suit from Salvation Army, and they dry clean them beforehand. He gets the suit and he reaches in the pocket and there's a $20 bill. So. It was a change of life for me. I saw numerous things, so far beyond the realm of coincidence that I knew that this was something special, that the teaching of our founder, the teaching of the purpose, pattern, and plan of Yahweh was unlike anything else I could have ever imagined. And as you proceed with learning more and more about it, I think you'll find that it gets better and better. Just a brief testimony, and now we'll get to somebody that knows how to do the teaching, and that's what you need. So anyway, thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Wunsch. So as we do on our Thursdays, I would like to open up the floor at this time for anybody who would like to offer a testimony, whether here or on Zoom. We only have a few participants, but if you'd like to give a testimony, I'll. All right. So for our next speaker, I would like to call Dr. Aaron Alanese.
Good evening, class.
Good evening.
We can blur that out. Yeah. I'll make it brief.
Take your time.
I really just am thankful. Like Bud, I've seen as much as Bud, but I've started to see things that are beyond coincidence. And it only makes me appreciate everything now, good or bad. And it's hard to appreciate the bad things that, or what we perceive as bad, or things at the time. But when you have the understanding and you can pull away from what this world is trying to put on you, and the lies and the darkness that they're trying to project. And when you could see it for what it really is, and you have an understanding, it gives you that comfort and that rest. I know I need rest. I'm exhausted. I find myself fighting to go to work in the morning. As much as I love coming here, it's a battle coming here sometimes. But again, those things that happen that are beyond coincidence are so inspiring, and they prick something that is unexplainable until you start seeing the pattern. Now, I've been really enjoying what the last few classes that we've had. It's been, again, not by coincidence, right along with what I've been studying on my own time and in my own time. And I mean, in retrospect, if you're studying about any of this, it's all aligning to the same thing, and that's Yahshua, the Messiah. But about the true gospel being preached. And it's saying that, it's said in the Bible that the true gospel must be preached, or will be preached, and then the end will come. Correct?
Matthew
24. Let's get it correctly. I was paraphrasing.
Matthew 24 and 13. But he that shall endure unto the end, the same shall be saved. And the gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations, and then shall the end come.
So if that had come to pass, what? If that had come to pass of the true gospel, which Christians and Catholics and all these other denominations are saying that they have the true gospel, and it's being spoken around the world, like that's the general. I remember I gave a lecture, and I went over the populations of the world and what most people believe in. And the majority of the world have Christian views, okay? Now, that's the majority of the world in population. Yet, here we still are. Meaning that not the majority of the world is preaching the true gospel. Now, that then comes to show, or then has the question, what is the true gospel? Okay? Now, if you were to go into any one of those churches and ask them to talk about the death, burial, and resurrection of Yahshua without using Matthew, Mark, Luke, or John, most, if not all, I can't say all because I don't know. There might be someone out there who knows. Cannot. Now, I say without using Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, because these things must come from the scriptures.
Right.
Now, to understand that a little bit more, you must understand what the scriptures are. And the scriptures are witnesses. They are the law and the prophets. Now, the law constituting the first five books of the Bible. The prophets is from Joshua to Malachi. This is what everybody at the time that these events that we have pictorially illustrated up here were going on, this is what they had to draw from. This is what they had to study. This is what they had, and they thought that they could obtain eternal life through these scriptures. Can we get that? You search the scriptures, for in them you think you have eternal life. So you had the scribes who would study this law and prophets every single, they lived the law and prophets as far as at face value. And they were searching them, and they thought they took it literally for what it was on the page. And Yahshua is speaking to them when he says this.
I'll go ahead and start at 36, okay. 5 and 36. But I have greater witness than that of John, for the works which the Father hath given me to finish, the same works I do, and they bear witness of me that the Father hath sent me. And the Father himself, which hath sent me, had borne witness of me. Ye have neither heard his voice at any time, nor seen his shape. And ye have not his word abiding in you. For whom he hath sent him, ye believe not. Ye search the scriptures, for in them ye think ye have eternal life. And they are they which testify of me.
So he was telling them, you're searching these scriptures for eternal life. But here I am. They were talking about me the entire time. Now, that's a huge statement to make to these guys who just, they know it back and forth. They could, You ask them a question of where to find this, and they'll just be like, here it is, here, and they could probably quote it to you. And he's telling them, you're in there memorizing all this, and you have no idea what they're talking about, what it's talking about. Because if you did, you would know that they were all talking about me.
And let's get to the law and to the prophets.
Isaiah 8:20. To the law and to the testimony. If they speak not according to this word, it is because there is no light in them.
So if they're not using the law and prophets to speak or to draw out what it actually is speaking about, Yahshua the Messiah, there's no light in them. They have no understanding. Now, if you go back to the law and prophets, you start to get some clarity, because you can pick up in Exodus where Yahweh reveals his name for the very first time. Now, if you're going to start a relationship with someone and you're trying to get to know them, you're going to want to know their name. So, if you're searching these scriptures and you're trying to get acquainted with your Savior, you want to know that name. It is very important to know the name of Yahweh and his son Yahshua. Right. And to know for yourself, for proof and foundation, where to find these things. It's Exodus
Third chapter,
3:16. Around there.
Do you want me to start from where he's at the burning bush, or?
Yeah, where he gives, yeah, I will be in. I will be what I will, and then he gives his name after that. All right. A little bit further down.
3:14. Exodus 3:14, and Elohim said unto Moses, Ayah Asher Ayah. And he said, thus shall thou say.
Let's not skip past that real quick, though. Ayah Asher Ayah, meaning, I will be what I will to be. Whatever I will to be, that is what I will be. An open statement, not limited by anything. But it is a title, still, not a name. Let's go further down to where we get the name.
And he said, thus shalt thou say unto the children of Israel, I will be hath sent me unto you. And Elohim said, moreover, unto Moses, thus shalt thou say unto the children of Israel, Yahweh, the Elohim of your fathers, the Elohim of Abraham, the Elohim of Isaac, and the Elohim of Jacob hath sent me unto you.
Yahweh, for the very first time, revealing his name to Moses. In the wilderness of Sinai, at the burning bush, while Moses was at the age of 80. Now, if you look here at the ages and dispensations chart, without even going into it, we just look at it at a little bit at face value, and we just look at, where's Moses on here? There's Melchizedek, Abraham, Mosaic Law. Okay? So from here to the fourth?
Yeah.
Fourth dispensation?
Yep.
Third age, fourth dispensation?
Correct.
Is where we finally get a name. All this time and events from Adam, Noah, Melchizedek, Abraham. So these are actually picked up back here in Genesis. So if you're reading this book straightforward, you're not even going to get a name until you get all the way over here into Exodus. So what were they calling them before? I think, is it in Exodus where it says, I appeared unto them as El Shaddai? I could say it, but I want to read it so it can...
Exodus 6 and 2. And Elohim spake unto Moses and said unto him, I am Yahweh. And I appeared unto Abraham, unto Isaac, and unto Jacob as El Shaddai. But by my name Yahweh was I not known to them.
Okay. Now I said, the name of Yahweh is very, very important. It's very important for many reasons. Why I want to say it's important is because the Son of Yahweh was going to come in his Father's name. Now, if that is true, and we know that the name of the Father is Yahweh, then it would bring up a question of where is that in this erroneous name of Jesus Christ that the world has accepted? It's not in there. But when we see this name of Yahshua, I see some similarities. We have Yah right here. Mm-hmm. We have Yah right here. Now, Y-A-H, Yah, is just a contracted form of Yahweh. You can see this in... I think it's the Psalms. I forget which division, but it's he's referred to as Yah, as a contraction. Now, if you look up Shua in Hebrew, because everything in Hebrew has meaning, all the names. If this is a contraction form of Yahweh, so this is Yahweh. Shua means salvation or is salvation. So all this is saying is Yahweh is salvation. So you have the Father, Yahweh, and the Word or Son, Yahshua. But he also dons the title, pluralistic title, of Elohim.
Right.
These three are one, a unity. Yahweh is pure spirit, and pure spirit are attributes in their purest form. Because that is what Yahweh is, and that's where the source of everything comes from. The source of wisdom, the source of intelligence, the source of knowledge, the source of love, the source of beauty, foundation, power, strength, justice. I know it's just nine principal attributes, but there's so much more. And it all comes from this pure spirit state, which is Yahweh. Now, because we can't understand pure spirit, because love, you can see the manifestation of it. You can see a parent who loves their child and they show affection, and you can see that. But we don't have some special binoculars that show a line of love going anywhere. That thing that we can't see is coming from this pure spirit state. Again, we can't see it, but this is the source. And knowing that we could not understand of Yahweh in this pure spirit state, it behooved them to transmute or suffer a death in part, not in totality, because it didn't take up the sum total of the pure spirit state of Yahweh to bring out the creation. So in part, as a super incorporeal form or being, donning a title of Elohim. Now, Yahweh is the Father because, again, he's the source of everything. It's like I don't want to twist that up. But after coming out of pure spirit, took on the shape and form transmuted into the superincorporeal form of Elohim. That is, having the shape and form of a man, but without having flesh and blood. Let's set into moderation, this form can be seen in divine visions and understood in divine revelations. Now, this Yahweh is still Yahweh here. Let's get that. In the beginning was the Word.
John 1:1. In the beginning was the Word.
The Word or Son, Yahshua, or Elohim. Elohim with the title. Superincorporeal form. Go ahead.
And the Word was with Yahweh.
The Word was with Yahweh.
And the Word was Yahweh.
And the Word was Yahweh.
The same was in the beginning with Yahweh. All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made.
The source of everything that was made. Now, later on, we get that. The Word became flesh.
Let me go down 14. 14th verse. And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us.
So this Word, or superincorporeal form, was made flesh. And walked around the earth as Yahshua the Messiah. Now, Yahshua is the name of the Holy Spirit in or out of a physical body. So that's why it could be, that's why it's still Yahshua over here, outside of a physical body, and Yahshua here, while being flesh. Mm-hmm. Now, again, the one Spirit, and having two manifestations, a three-in-one configuration. Mm-hmm. Moses also received not here at the burning bush, but on the second trip up the mountain of Mount Sinai, after he came back down and was a vessel to help lead the children of Israel out of Egypt, to which they camped here in the wilderness of Mount Sinai. The first trip were spoken down the Ten Commandments. And then the second trip, Moses, Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu were called upon to come up not to the top of the mountain, but to this plateau, to where they saw the Elohim of Israel. Now, after they saw this, they were told to tarry here whilst Moses and his minister Yahshua went into the fiery cloud. Now, in this fiery cloud, Moses receives a vision. And he sees the tabernacle pattern. Well, first he sees Elohim. And then Elohim transmutes. Would it be? Transfigures. Into this fully furnished tabernacle. But it was not explained to him at this point. He then transfigured back into Elohim. And from Elohim, from this point, he started showing Moses the creation of the world. And he showed him this in 6 solar days. Now, that's how long that vision was. It did not take Elohim or Yahweh 6 solar days to create anything. He merely willed it, and so it was. So each day, he would show him the day, and he'd come back into himself as an Elohim. Then he'd open it up again, and he'd come back into himself. Open it, and just kept going, and all the way until the 6th day. And on the 7th day, he rested. And for the remainder 33 days, he showed them the inner workings and the functions of this threefold tabernacle pattern. Now, this pattern is the pattern of everything. Nothing escapes this pattern. This tabernacle pattern consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court roundabout, making a one tabernacle, three sections, making the one, the unity. Just like we have, just like the names and title, you may seem like three different things, but it is, again, one. This is a unity. Now, I talked about the true gospel. I don't want to take up too much time, but I don't want to pass over that because I did state it. The true gospel is the preaching of the death, burial, and resurrection. Yahshua was preaching the death, burial, resurrection according to the scriptures. And that's what we're doing. We are preaching about the true gospel according to the scriptures. And that how he died, was buried, and rose again the third day. Again, I don't have too much more to say. I want to get it a little bit more cleaner before I go too deep into it. So if you got anything out of that, all praise be to Yahweh through Yahshua the Messiah, his only son and only hope of glory. Thank you.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Dr. Alanis. I'll be the next speaker for tonight's class. I truly appreciate the remarks from the previous two speakers. And there's some good things said. And it was a good foundation, actually, that was set up for somebody to be able to springboard off of. So you did a good job, you know, setting it up. I could go in a lot of different directions right now, and I have a particular course that I'd like to go into and talk about some things. I just wanted to be sure you've been to class for some time, on and off a little bit. You do have a little bit of background in this teaching, or is it just really, really basic? I'd like to know, because I want to kind of know. Really basic? Okay, so as Will Williams liked to say, I guess I'd like to boil some milk with some meat a little bit so that we all can get something out of this. Because you've been a few times, right? Awesome. For some
for some time. Okay. Well, so what the previous speaker was doing was laying a foundation of the basic, some of the basic tenets of this doctrine that we have here. One of the things that he was talking about just at towards the end of his discourse was the vision of Moses and where we get Genesis from in the Bible. So when you open up your Bible and you have Genesis 1:1, it's in the beginning of the book and it talks about the beginning. But there's a huge question as to how that got put in, you know, how we got that written into the book. And a lot of people just assume, because they don't have the answer, that the Word is the Bible. And the Bible was the first thing that was created, and it was just floating around, flapping and creating, you know, the trees and the birds and the bees and what have you. And that's really not, it doesn't make sense. It sounds ridiculous. And here in this school, as is said in the moderation, that we show proof that everything is made according to the pattern. And when we're proving this thing, we prove how the scriptures were written, where they derived from, how they came out. Now, the first speaker had Exodus, the third chapter, called around the 14th verse. And right around in that 14th verse, we got the name of our Heavenly Father. Now, the world calls our Heavenly Father the Lord. Well, you don't put the before your name. Lord is a title. It's not a name. Every time I mention this, I say if you're renting a house and you got a landlord, if you write the check out to landlord, they're going to come back and say, you need to fix this. I need my name put on here, or the company name or something, but you can't put it towards the title of landlord because it's just not cashable. It's useless. And in Exodus 20:7, if you could get that for me, it reads that, you know, one of the commandments that we have that they teach in the church, it says that, you know, we don't want to take that name and make it useless. So if you get, whenever you get that, go ahead and read.
Exodus 20, chapter and 6 verse. And
7.
7 verse.
Mm-hmm.
Thou shalt not take away the name of Yahweh, thy Elohim.
Thou shalt not take away the name of Yahweh, thy Elohim. Now, we didn't have that name, as a previous speaker had called, and we don't have to get it. They didn't have that name. Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the forefathers of Moses, which that's important to realize, is that Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and let's go ahead and get that again. Let's go back over to Exodus 6:2 and read that really quick, just so that we can pick up that thought again, because I want to go back into that, because it was a good thing that he was talking about, and I think it would be good for us to just kind of nail that down whenever you're ready.
Exodus 6:2.
Mm-hmm.
And Elohim spake unto Moses and said unto him, I am Yahweh. And I appeared unto Abraham, unto Isaac, and unto Jacob as El Shaddai.
Right.
But
he appeared unto them as El Shaddai, which El Shaddai means Almighty Provider. That's what that means. It's a title. It's a contracted form of Elohim and Almighty Provider. So that's just like the same principle as landlord. It's not a name. It's a title. And then go ahead and read.
But by my name, Yahweh, was I not known to them.
He was not known to them by that name. So, you know, that leaves a big question as to when you're going into reading through Genesis, you've got Lord and God written all through the book of Genesis. But if you go and you turn to Genesis 1:1 really quick, and if you've got a good Bible and you look at the header of Genesis 1:1, what does it say in the header above, before you start reading, before in the beginning or whatever, what does it say there? Who's credited to that book? It's the question. What I'm trying to get at is that is the it says it's the first book of Moses. So Moses is credited for writing that book. But Moses was not alive. This chart right here, we call this the elementary chart for short. It's more polytechnically named the chart on the pattern or plan of salvation. So this chart patterns out the plan of salvation for you to understand. And it's in a somewhat linear fashion, starting here in the creation of the earth with Adam and ending here where Yahshua's second coming and the new earth state, if you will. We also got the same thing up here going from eternity and all of these circles. They're all linked like a chain all throughout the creation and then the kingdom of Elohim in the new earth state over here. So you got the same thing here as you got going across through here, but it's more drawn out threefold in this manner down here. This out aligned with the tabernacle pattern, which we have right here. That's the pattern of the tabernacle. This being the most holy place all the way across. This being the holy place. And this being the court roundabout in that tabernacle pattern. And we say we go forth to show it how that everything is made according to this pattern of this court roundabout, holy place, and most holy place. I'll get back to this. One big thing that you have right on you, you walked in the door with it, is your physical body that's made according to the pattern of this tabernacle. And your head cavity being like unto your most holy place. When inside of that head cavity, you have your brain. And your brain is made up of gray and white matter. And it has no particular or descriptive shape and form. It's like a cloudy-like substance. And if you take it out of that chamber of your head cavity, it'll look like a bunch of mush. You know, it'll take on the shape kind of like water in a glass. It'll take on the shape of wherever you put it. If you put it in a glass, it'll be the shape of a glass. You put it in the trash can, it'll be shaped like the trash can. I wouldn't recommend it. But that being like unto the most holy place in this tabernacle where the cloud would dwell in between the two angels on the Ark of the Covenant, overshadowing the Ark of the Covenant. And in your head, you have your the right hemisphere and the left hemisphere, which is likened unto these Michael and Gabriel up here, being your warrior and your messenger angel. And you have the law that's written in your heart and your pituitary gland that regulates how big you're going to be, you know, all your DNA functions and things like that. And then moving on down, you have a separation from your head cavity. Your neck separates your chest cavity there. And in your chest cavity, you have your lungs and your heart and what do you call that? I can't remember right now.
Aorta?
Yeah, your aorta, which feeds all of your extremities. It feeds all of your organs and your arms and your legs. That's where all your blood pumps out through. So, and that's likened unto this seven branch, because it's a seven branch aortic artery. It's likened unto this seven branch candle lampstand. Thank you for that. And then your table of shewbread. We can go. I'm not going to go into detail, but that correlates with your heart and the lobes, the chambers, and everything. You can come back and we'll get into detail with that. Your lungs are likened unto the altar of incense, being a sweet smelling savor unto Yahweh. Without your lungs, you wouldn't have the oxygen flowing into your brain, giving you, you know, what you need to for your brain to function and what have you. So all of these things have a function in this tabernacle, all of these furnishings, and down in your court round about.
I want to
go ahead.
Question: when dealing with the aorta, mm-hmm. artery, mm-hmm. you see underneath that aorta branch there, you see that blue?
Yeah.
That's depicting the deoxygenated blood.
Okay.
And then the red is why it's primarily red, is the oxygenated blood.
Right.
Because it is the oxygenated blood that's giving the body life. Because when that deoxygenate comes in, it comes in and gets re-cleaned. So we're dealing with not all of the aorta, but the oxygenated portion of the aorta that's giving light or life to the body. So it's not the whole aorta system. It is the oxygenated portion of the aorta artery. So that's just a part, because it's synonymous with the light of the candlestick. But we know they put that candlestick out at night, but mm-hmm. yet the sun during the day kept it lit at all times in the holy place, just as that blood is constantly pumping throughout our body.
Right.
I just wanted to bring that out as far as the specific about the aorta.
Right. No, you
remember about.
It's a good point. So with this, and I wasn't going to go into too much detail, since you did, it's a really good point that you went into, is that this aorta, it carries oxygenated and oxygenated blood through your heart. And in the tabernacle, during the day, the veil is open and the sun shines in. So they put the light out during the day. And then when it comes in the evening, they light this candlestick.
Through the evening.
And it provides light so that this is never in darkness, this holy place inside of here. You never want this place in darkness. It's just like if in your physical body, if you're in darkness in here, things aren't operating properly. He is the light. If we read over there, back over in John 1 and finish off where we or pick it back up where we ended, like 1 and 4, 5, something like that, where he is the light. Since we're talking about that, that's a good point. And what we're doing right now is, if you pay attention, you will see that we're making correlations between the physical things of the creation of the world and this tabernacle pattern. This tabernacle that was given, instructed Moses to build. As the previous speaker said, he was called up into the Mount Sinai. And on his second trip, he was shown the 7 days of the creation. That's why I was getting that in Genesis. But he's seen the seven days of the creation, and he was up there for a total of 40 days. And for the remaining 33 days that he was up there, he was given in great detail instructions on how to build this tabernacle that was instructed to be built and pitched out here in the wilderness of Sinai. And the 12 tribes of Israel that had been brought up out of this bondage as a result of the miracles of the 10 devastating plagues that Yahweh poured out on the land of Egypt. The Pharaoh cast them out of the land after those 10 devastating plagues were poured out, and they crossed the divided waters of the Red Sea and went out here into this wilderness of Sinai, and they were to be out there for 40 days. And there were 3 trips that Moses was called up into the mount to worship Yahweh. And when he was called up the first time, he was given down the 10 commandments, where we talked about with the Exodus 20 and 7, where he says, "Don't take my name and bring it to nothing." And then in the second trip that he came up, and there were other commandments as well in that first trip, but moving on to the second trip that he was called up there, he was shown these days of the creation that you have here in Genesis 1 and 1. When you read Genesis 1 and 1, and we'll get back to it, but before we get back there, because that's where I was going, We're over in John, and we're talking about this light right now, because we made mention of this seven-branch aortic artery correlating to this seven-branch candle lampstand. And let's go ahead and read there.
Okay. I'm going to start with one. That way we remember what the scripture is.
That's
John,
very good.
John chapter 1. In the beginning was the Word, mm-hmm. and the Word was with Yahweh.
In the beginning was the Word. Now, that's not to be confused with the Bible. You go to church, and they say, everybody grab your Bibles and say, I got my Word. Yeah, I've been there a couple of times. And they wait, and you're waving the Word around, and you're supposed to repeat after me and all of this stuff, and you stand up and wave your hands around and say anointing a couple times, and you know, you go home feeling good. Until your wife say you ain't making enough money and the guy across the street's got a nicer car than you, you know, and things like that. But we want you to know what the Word is. The Word, as is expressed in the moderation, I'm not going to go to this chart. The Word as expressed in the moderation is Yahweh coming out of his pure spirit state of divine intelligence, wisdom, knowledge, beauty, love, justice, foundation, power, and strength, wrapped up in the kingdom of Yahweh. He took on a shape and form as Elohim, being a super incorporeal being, not a book. He is the book of life, but he's not a book that you read and flip the pages through. He is the truth. He is everything that exists that you can and can't perceive, whether you like it or not. And with him taking on shape and form in his sonship degree, that is Yahweh Elohim. Whether he is in a body as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world calls Jesus Christ, or out of the body, who will appear to you in visions, which are likened unto dreams, which we all, most of us have had, and be revealed to you in revelations. So you can have a dream, but if you don't have the revelation of that dream, then you don't really understand what that dream means, what the substance of that dream is all about. Now, go ahead and read. In the beginning was the Word.
In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with Yahweh,
mm-hmm.
and the Word was Yahweh.
The Word was Yahweh. The Word was Yahweh, intelligence, wisdom, knowledge, beauty, love, justice, foundation, power, and strength, taken on shape and form. His attributal makeup took it on shape and form to create the creation. It is said in this school where Yahweh, he created his son, and then Yahweh in his pure spirit state went out of business. He went out of the creating business right then and there. And he gave all the rest of the creation to be created to his son. It doesn't take all of Yahweh to make up Yahweh Elohim. This is Yahweh in part, not in totality. And what we want you to know coming down to this school is that you are made in the likeness and image of Yahweh Elohim. And we want you to become aware of that. And once you become aware of that, you are truly blessed. The Word was with Yahweh, and the Word was Yahweh. Read.
The same was in the beginning with Yahweh. All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made.
All things were made by him, and not without him was not anything made that was made. I just said that. Read.
In him was life.
In him was life. Read.
And the life was the light of men.
The life was the light of man. You've got this court roundabout, this holy place, and this most holy place, okay? Now, this is the man made in the image by the pattern of the tabernacle chart right here. Now, this is our we call this the migratory chart or the Moses chart. Now, this is threefold as well, and you've got the outer court or the court roundabout as depicted over here, B, being Egypt down here, and you've got this tabernacle right here, court round about. So this is darkness. This is a like a death-like state for you down here in Egypt, in this outer court. So we're talking about the light. And now where you have light in this tabernacle, the first place that you have light in this tabernacle, going according to the steps, and I'm going to go through the steps, is once you get into this holy place. Now you've got seven steps in this tabernacle. Your first step is down at the gate, the entrance to the tabernacle. Your second step is the brazen altar of sin offering. And that's where the sacrifices for the people, that the tribes that camped around this tabernacle in the wilderness, the 12 tribes, and for the high and the low priest, they were put on this altar of sin offering. The third step is your altar of brazen laver. And I'll come over here. The altar of brazen laver, where the sacrifice would be washed and the high and the low priest would be washed before officiating in this tabernacle. Your fourth step is at the door to the holy place. And before these priests could go and begin officiating in this holy place, they had to be anointed, which is like an quickening, which is like was like a type and shadow of that Holy Spirit being poured on them. And there's a little cup of a holy anointing oil that it gets poured over those priests before they can go in here. And once you get that anointing at this door, you can proceed into the holy place. And once you're in the holy place, you've got this light in here. Now, out here, it's considered to be in darkness. Even though you got the sun during the day, at night, it's dark out here around this court roundabout. But it's always light inside of this holy place, whether it be day or whether it be night. And that's a type and shadow of Yahshua the Messiah. He is the light.
You want to read that?
We're reading it right now, kind of. But yeah, we want to get that other one. Okay. That's great. But let's finish up right here before we move on. And yeah, if you can hold that, please.
And the light shineth in darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not.
The light shineth in the darkness, and the darkness didn't comprehend. The darkness couldn't understand what this light is all about. Read.
There was a man sent from Yahweh whose name was John.
Okay, that's good. That's good. Now the previous speaker had skipped over to that 14th verse, and that being that word was made flesh. And that's where we explain that Yahweh, he knew that man could not perceive of him in this pure spirit state, so he took on shape and form as Elohim. And then he went further on and manifested himself in a physical body as Yahshua, being righteousness, peace, and joy, and all understanding of who his heavenly Father is, being in a fleshly state. He was made in the likeness of sinful flesh, but he was not sinful flesh. And we need to know what sin is in order to know what sinful flesh is. Well, a sin is a transgression of the law. And what is the law? The law is the 613 statutes, judgments, and ordinances that were dictated or given to the children of Israel that they agreed to. They agreed to this law. The Hebrews agreed to follow all the laws that were rained down or thundered down from the from this mountain that Yahweh had commanded these people to do. And there were 613 of them, 603 more than the 10 that is talked about in Christendom for the most part. And we want you to know that. And what is it? 6 and 28, Deuteronomy 6 and 28, where it says if you break one of them, you're guilty of them all. But before we get off of that light, did you have that?
I was going to have John 8 and 12.
Go ahead.
Then spake Yahshua again unto them, saying, I am the light of the world.
Mm-hmm.
He that followeth me shall not walk in darkness, but shall have the light of life.
He has a light of life.
That follows after Yahshua, whom said that he is the light of the world, just as it was in first, as it was in John 1 and 4, that he lighteth the light of every man.
He lighteth the light of every man. Now, over here on this elementary chart that we were talking about, when and just to give an example of how these things are made according to this tabernacle pattern, is on this plate right here, you have the, and this is a plate, this, all this 1, 2, 3, that's one plate. 1, 2, 3, that's another plate. 1, 2, 3, there's another plate. So all the way down, these are all plates. And each one of these plates is made like this, put together like this tabernacle pattern. And what we do, these are just pictorial illustrations of your Bible, the accounts in your Bible. So you've got over here, you've got, let's get 1 John, King James Version, 1 John, 5 and 7? And I want to correlate that light with Yahshua the Messiah right now. That's the reason why I'm on this right now. So we've got three that bear record in heaven.
For there are three that bear record in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit.
Mm-hmm.
And these three are one.
That's written right here on the top. There are three that bear record in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit. And these three are one. Now, that's the spiritual things. Those are the invisible things from the creation of the world, and we're going to get that. But just let's keep on reading.
And there are three that bear witness in earth.
Mm-hmm. There are three that bear record in heaven, and there are three that bear witness in earth. Read.
The Spirit, and the water, and the blood, and these three agree in one.
Now you got the Spirit. Now if we draw a line from this Spirit right here on this chart, you go right over here, and then boom, you got that light, Yahshua being the light, that Holy Spirit, that lights the world.
The Spirit be the holy anointing oil at the door, because it's the Spirit.
Oh yeah, that's right. You're right. Yeah.
Mm. I'm sorry. Keep going. You're right. But it's at the door.
It is. It is in this holy place. And all right. What I'm trying to show forth is that everything that we have is threefold. You've got the Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit. You've got the Spirit, the water, and the blood. Now, the unity of the Spirit being the Father in his pure spirit state, that attributal makeup that's inscrutable and incomprehensible and indiscernible to mankind. And then him taking on shape and form into a super incorporeal being, being the Word, not your Bible, but that's him taking on shape and form in a super incorporeal state. And then the Holy Spirit being manifest in a physical body, being that third state of that unity. It's all the same thing. Yahshua was that Word being made flesh, as it's read in John 1 and 14.
That's right.
There's no separation between Yahshua and the Word and Yahweh. Those three are one. And in your physical body, a witness to that, your spirit, your water and your blood, they must agree in one, or your physical body will not be able to function and operate. When you take in breath, it's called inspiration, and that's likened unto spirit. And in this holy place up here, you've got the altar of incense, which is a type of the inspiration that happens with your lungs, being that spirit, a type and shadow of that spirit. You see the spirit right here. It's on this side. Yes, you have the anointing. You have that anointing oil at the door. You have to have that anointing. Everything that is beyond this door is covered with the anointing of Yahshua. Everything beyond this door, you can't go and do anything inside of here without that anointing.
And that anointing is that spirit that's not in the holy place. That's blood, water, the brazen altar, the laver,
blood,
and the cup of oil.
Water.
The holy anointing oil is in the court roundabout at the door.
It's at the door.
Right, not in the holy place.
Well, it's not in the holy place, but it's at the entrance to the holy place.
Yes, sir. That's right.
So you can't get, that's the guard, like this,
right,
like this angel,
mm-hmm,
right here,
exactly,
that's stopping Adam and Eve from coming back up into the garden. That, see, they lost, they went into a fallen state over here and were driven out of that garden, and they were cast out. And then, and I'm glad that you're bringing this up, because this is what I wanted to get into about, because what we had read in the scripture lesson today in the second chapter of Joel. Now, see, Adam and Eve were in the rest up here in this garden. All the trees in this garden were in fruition. They didn't have to work. They didn't need no clothes. Everything was provided. When you go back to this vision that Moses had up here on the mountain, you read Genesis 1 and 1, that first chapter of Genesis, all the way through to the seventh day, where it says, on the seventh day, Yahweh Elohim rested from all of the things that he had created. And once he rested, he went for the next 33 days into this. See, when he went into this rest, that's when Moses, that's the last thing that he's seen, him in the rest with Adam and Eve, and righteousness, peace, and joy, enjoying the fruits of the creation, enjoying the fruits of the labor of Yahweh that Yahweh had made. They were in the rest-like state at this time. And then Yahweh took his attention, Moses' attention, away from the creation, because the creation had been completed. And he took it over to this tabernacle and how man was made according to the structure and function of the tabernacle, so that Moses would have some kind of way, so that we would have some kind of way to know how this creation was made in the likeness and image of Yahweh. That's why it was so important for this tabernacle to be drawn out, and why, and that anointing oil, that anointing that we're talking about at that door, because you're not getting into this holy place without it. You can move all around the court roundabout without that anointing, but you can't go into the holy place without it. That's breaking the rules. That's against the pattern. That's a perversion of the pattern. And what we have is we've got one spirit, being Yahweh, in operation in this whole universe. Universe meaning one. There ain't. It's not a multiverse. It's a universe. You got one spirit. One spirit being one vision. And you got two mysteries. You got the mystery of righteousness, and you've got the mystery of iniquity. And you see on this chart, you've got this mystery of righteousness that is made according to the tabernacle pattern. And he's a host in righteousness. He's a healer. He's a provider. He is the banner. He's a shepherd. And he's in his rest here in the Sabbath. He's being, and this is the, you can see the shadow of a woman here in Yahweh being the husbandman who rained down his law from the Mount Sinai for those children of Israel, for the Jews and the Jews only. And the Jew, the spiritual bride, in type and shadow, being made in his likeness and image. And when they follow that law, that whole law, that would be their righteousness, their joy, and their peace. That would be their salvation. But them Jews, they couldn't follow the law. They broke at least one, each and every one of them, broke at least one of them laws, corrupting that law. And they were found in a state of not being equal with righteousness. And that's why that old boy Satan that you got in Revelations 12 and 9 and 10, he said, was deceived the whole world. Now, that's for another class. I don't want to get too far into that. But let me get back onto the track of what I'm saying. Is, see, everything goes by according to the pattern. And what we want to do is we want to recognize if whatever we're dealing with is the truth or if it's not the truth. Because everything is made according to the pattern. So if you can prove it, 1 Thessalonians 5:21, please. If you can prove it, then it's good for food. But if there's no proof according to this pattern, then it's not good. Whenever you're ready. We want to do an investigation of all of these things that we experience. And we want to, if we can, this being our schoolmaster, this tabernacle, the pattern of this tabernacle being this schoolmaster, if Yahweh willing, we want to line up the principles of this blood or death or sacrifice in everything that we have, that we deal in. The inundation, the water being a washing, an inundation or regeneration in principle. The anointing, as we talked about with being spirit or quickening or thing like that, according the in principle. All right? And moving on forth, being light, bread, or substance, or an intercessor. And so on and so forth. You got it yet? 1 Thessalonians 5:21?
1 Thessalonians 5 and 21.
Right.
Prove all things, hold fast that which is good.
Prove all things and hold fast that which is good. We want to prove it all. We want to prove the righteous things and we want to prove the things of iniquity. Well, we don't want to just, oh, that's iniquity. We're not going to look at that at all. We need to look at that. We need to look at it and see what it is. We don't want to hold on to that. That must be cast out. Those, we can't follow the things of iniquity. We need to hold on to those righteous principles of Yahweh. It said obedience is better than chastisement, right? We following the law of Yahweh. We don't want to be led to and fro and led astray like silly women taken captive by various lusts, if you will. We want to stay on this pattern that we have. And that's what we're doing down here, is we're going forth to show how all of these scriptures are outlined according to the pattern. And then once you start seeing the principle of how this tabernacle is made in the likeness is made in the likeness and image of Yahweh, and we are made in the likeness and image of Yahweh according to this tabernacle. The scriptures are just a witness, a type and shadow of how that is actualized. And that's what we're doing, is we're proving all of the things and holding fast to that which is good. Okay.
Romans 1:19, 20. I feel like I'm missing something here. I went off on a tangent. Give me Romans, please, 1:19 and 20.
Because that which may be known of Yahweh is manifest in them.
Because that which may be known of Yahweh, Yahweh being pure spirit, knowing that you can't understand him in his pure spirit state, he had to come down into shape and form so that you could know something about him, and that's what we're talking about. Read.
For Yahweh have showed it unto them.
And that's what we coming down here to this school. He's showing it to us right now. If you sit in your seat, you pay attention, you can know something. He's showing it to you. It's for not me. It's not Marlon. It's not Aaron. It's not Bud. It's Yahweh. If you know anything about Yahweh in righteousness, the good things that you're supposed, we're proving all things and holding fast to that which is good, those good things that we hold on to, Yahweh showed it to you. Read.
For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, understood by the things that are made.
The invisible things are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made. This tabernacle was something that was invisible to Moses until he came up here into this mount. And then he was shown these 6 days of the creation. And then he was shown in a vision. It was made manifest to him how this tabernacle was to be built. And he was instructed to build one exactly like it in detail. And then once it was built, it was actualized and made manifest for the Jews and the Jews only to make atonement, to use to make atonement for the sins that they sinned when they transgressed the law that was given to them. Drinking a little bit of liquor is not a law unto your death. Smoking a cigarette is not a sin. Calling your mama that's a transgression of the law if you are a Jew. If you're not a Jew, you're not breaking the law by calling your mama a bad name or calling your dad a bad name. It was for the Jews and the Jews only. What was that?
At that time.
At that time. Because what we're here to tell you right now is that this law was given to the Jews and none of these Jews could follow this law. So, what was it, 1600 some years after this law was instituted?
1490.
1400, where we got that right here?
Moses' vision. Moses 1490.
1490. So from 1490, it's 1600 years later after this vision. Yahshua came on the scene, born a virgin birth. And the purpose for him coming, he came in like he was a specially prepared body, and he came to fulfill this law. That's what his purpose was. And he came on down, and he got up to the age of 30, and then he went into his ministry at the age of 30. After him being baptized here, and he went on fulfilling or completing all these 613 statutes, judgments, and ordinances, all of these laws, the circumcisions, the ceremonies. See, the circumcision was fulfilled when he was 8 days old. And he was following the ceremonies and whatnot as he was raised up in his mother's house, and he wasn't the son of Mary and Joseph, but the world looked at him as he was the son of Mary and Joseph, but he really wasn't. He's the son of man, but he went through his whole life following all of these statutes, judgments, and ordinances, and he died on a cross, the death of the outcast dog, in fulfillment of the prophecy of the scriptures. It was read, Isaiah 8 and 20. Let's get it again. See, it was read John 5, 39. You search the scriptures, for in them ye think ye have eternal life, but they are they which testify of me. And we go over here to Isaiah 8 and 20.
Isaiah 8 and 20. to the law, no, to the law and to the testimony. If they speak not according to this word, it is because there is no light in them.
There's no light in them. He already said he was the light. We already nailed that down. Now, everything that he did was fulfilling. He spoke. Everything that he spoke was in fulfillment of that law and that testimony, the scriptures. When he got up on this cross, he was fulfilling the sacrifice that was to be made for the atonement of the sins of these of the Jews in this tabernacle. The earth being the greater and more perfect tabernacle, or the universe, if you will, being the greater and more perfect tabernacle. And he died, and on the Sabbath, he was put in Joseph's new tomb. He did no work. He wasn't breathing. His heart wasn't pumping. He wasn't milling around the house waiting for the next day so he can get back out. He did, into a scientific measure, he did no work. That's another fulfillment. He fulfilled all things. He died. He buried. He resurrected on on the third day. And he tarried. He was seen among the Jews. He was seen among the people. He tarried with them for 40 days. He resurrected, and he tarried with them for 40 days out there in Jerusalem. And he ascended. And then 10 days after he ascended, he poured out his Holy Spirit, ushering in a new law. So now you don't got to go get your foreskin cut off of your baby on the eighth day no more. You don't got to go get no crackers and grape juice every first Sunday of the month no more. We don't got to go get dunked in some dirty, parasite-ridden water behind the altar at the church no more. We don't got to wear no Teflons on our foreheads no more. We don't got to wrap our arms up with bands and things no more so that we can remember some of these laws and statutes, judgments, and ordinances. You had a question? Matthew. Go ahead. Matthew 5:17. This is what we're talking about. Let's read it.
Think not that I've come to destroy the law.
He didn't come to destroy all of them 613 statutes, judgments, and ordinances that were given to the Jews, because we need them to know why and what he's doing. Read.
Or the prophets.
Or the prophets. That first five books being the law, where you got. He's not trying to destroy. And then the rest, Joshua through Malachi being the prophets. He didn't come to destroy it. That's why we still got it in the book to reference. Now, you got your New Testament Christians that don't even want to read it no more. They didn't destroy it. State of not being equal with righteousness. That's what we're looking at. We proving all things and holding fast. This got to be cast out. We holding fast to that which is good down here in this school.
I'm not come to destroy,
mm-hmm.
but to establish.
But to fulfill. Is more correctly.
But to fulfill.
In the King James Version, it says fulfill.
That's right.
In A.B. Traynor, he messes up some things. But we don't got one book that is written out correctly. Now, that's that proving of all things allows us to have some discernment to where we can make corrections for mistranslated and erroneously substituted words according to a pattern. Because if it don't speak according to the law of the prophecy, there ain't no light in it. We just read that. So if somebody got something written the wrong way up there in the book, but you got another version where it's written the right way, well, you know there ain't no light where it's not written according to the law, to this pattern. And that's what we're doing. That's what we want you to do. That's what we want you to focus. This all of this stuff that's all around this room, are there tools? Use these as tools. We want, see what, all right. We want you to be inundated. We want you, we don't want to put you in no dirty water down here. We want to put you in some living water, which is the kingdom of Yahshua, which is the truth. We want the people who come down here and study in this school to seek the truth in all things, because that is Yahshua. And we want you to get inundated in the truth of why Yahshua died, why he was buried, and how he resurrected. Because that's the preaching of the gospel. And as the founder of this school said, true preaching is teaching. So if you're not learning something, then something's wrong. Well, I'm out of time. But I urge you, I'm not mad or anything like that. I know my face get all scrunched up. That's just my passion. It's a matter of life and death, you know, in the most literal sense. Like, you know, we wake up every day, we go through our days, we gotta pay the bills, pay the car note. We got our boyfriends and girlfriends that want us to take us out, take them out to eat and buy them stuff. And, you know, they distract us from Yahweh. And what we come down here three times a week, 2 hours, which is not very much time, we try to show you that all of these things that you out here in the world that we long for, the pride of life and the lust of the flesh and all of these things that we yearn for, you know, the 401ks and, you know, grandchildren and all of those things, you know, they're a distraction that keeps you away from focusing on your heavenly Father Yahweh. And that's all that we want you to do. Is we don't pass around no collection plates. We don't want nobody paying for nothing. The bills got to get paid around here. But really, the main thing that we want from people who come down here is just to pay attention, show up on time, and, you know, just pay attention and don't believe anything that any of us says just because we say it. Don't take it at face value. You know, this is a school. It's not a place where we just saying a whole bunch of stuff. We want you to go do some research. Take the things that we said and go do an investigation for your own self in, you know, dictionaries, encyclopedias, and all of the different venues that you have out here in the world. One of the aims is to study comparative religion, psychology, philosophy, modern practical occult science, and the scriptures. We want you to study all of these things. And we want you to come to a profound knowledge and understanding of these things that you're studying. And we want you to remain a skeptic until you do. And if anything was got out of what was said today, then all praises be to our Heavenly Father Yahweh through His only begotten Son, Yahshua the Messiah. Hallelujah. Thank you. That will conclude today's class. Dr. Reiser, our thoughts are with her daughter, Dr. Stephanie, and she's not feeling well right now. So Dr. Reiser is with her, you know, making sure she's making a recovery and whatnot. So our thoughts are with her right now. And Samuel is recovering. Samuel is, you know, being Samuel, he don't want anybody to fuss over him, but he's recovering and he's getting his strength back. He messaged you on Facebook. Okay, so yeah, he's reaching out. So that's Dr. Love said he's in good spirits, if you will. So that's good. Yeah, so we're looking forward to his return. where there's going to be a symposium in Texas coming up here. We're going to get some details for that. That was just announced. They just found a place for the hotel and venue and whatnot. So as that unfolds a little bit more in detail, then we'll, you know, 10th, 11th, and 12th of December, we'll have that going, and we'll give more information as we, you know, get it outlined better for you. But that's coming up, so we'll be encouraged. We try to, you know, get some people from our class to get some attendance in that. But, yeah, that's all. we hold classes here at 1816 East Elma Court in Ontario, California, every Tuesday and Thursday from 7:30 p.m. to 9:30 p.m., and every Sunday from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. Please bring all your friends and all your enemies, because this is truly the place to learn something truthful about your Heavenly Father, Yahweh. Let us all stand to be dismissed with the doxology taken from the last two verses of Jude. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise Elohim, our Savior, through Yahshua the Messiah, our Sovereign, belong glory and majesty, dominion and power, both before all time, now and ever. Let us all say, Hallelujah.